Hi everyone and good evening from UK. Thank you all for finding time and visiting today's webinar. My name is Zazel Hashimi and I'll be your moderator for this session. I'm a petroleum engineer and doing my master's degree at University of Essex. Our webinar today is about subsea engineering overcoming the challenging of an oil price downturn. And I'm pleased to introduce today's speaker, Engineer Ibrahim Fahmi Abdul Ati. Ibrahim Fahmi, fellow Emeritus Chartered Engineer, Chartered Marine Engineer, Independent Consultant, Offshore and Marine Projects, based in Windsor. 20 years of experience in offshore, subsea, and marine industries, where he covered different technical and management roles. Engineer Ibrahim has served international major companies and joint ventures in Aberdeen, Abu Dhabi, Sharjah, and Alexandria. Engineer Ibrahim chaired and led technical committees of several remarkable international conferences such as Abu Dhabi International Petroleum Exhibition, Offshore and Marine Conference 2015-2019. Engineer Ibrahim is a winner of multiple outstanding awards in offshore and projects, Regional SPE Award in Projects 2017, and Abu Dhabi National Oil Company Group Health Safety Environment Award 2013. I believe we will have a real informative session this evening. So without any delay, Engineer Ibrahim, you can start the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Russell, for the introduction. Thank you, Dr. Ahmed, for organizing this webinar. And I would like to thank also Marietta College, Ohio in the United States, the Department of Petroleum Engineering, Arab Oil and Gas Academy, Society of Petroleum Engineers, SPE Egypt Section, and PayoPetro for organizing this series of webinars. Hello everyone, Assalamu Alaikum. I am Ibrahim Fahmi and I am very happy to be with you today in our webinar. Warm greeting from Windsor. I am based in Windsor in UK. Today is a sunny and windy day, so we have a lot of energy to present our slides. We are focusing on subsea engineering overcoming the challenges of an oil price downturn. The third downturn in the last 12 years. I will focus today, I will take the subject from leadership and strategy perspective. As all of us are aware, what happened in the last few months from COVID-19 and the consequences. But I will start first with give you about short introduction about subsea engineering and underwater technology. The breakthrough of subsea industry in the last 20 years enabled exploration and production from fields offshore, deep and ultra deep water, which were impossible to reach or develop without the state-of-the-art subsea engineering and underwater technology. The total value of United Kingdom subsea industry output has increased to almost £8 billion from a couple of years. It's one third of the global market, which worth around £21 billion annually. But we are talking here about this number is confirmed from organization Subsea UK, but it measures the direct investment. The indirect investment, I believe that is more than five times these numbers, because if you are executing a project in subsea. And all manufacturing around the subsea, I talk about even the onshore after that, all of this investment is related to the subsea. If the subsea technology cannot develop the field, so that means the whole investment of the project will not be carried out. So the indirect investment at least 5 times. We are talking about the UK. In other countries, it increased in values because of you are developing countries like Angola or Botswana or South Africa. So the total value of the investment, direct and indirect, I think will be more than 5 times. UK remains the market leader in underwater engineering, manufacturing products and services. The industry value reached the 9 billion in 2013, but as you know, it's a fluctuation in the oil price in the last 10 years up and down. So in 2013, the direct jobs in UK, it was 53,000 jobs related to subsea industry. There is some collapse in 2017 related to some oil price problems, but still we are maintaining the 45,000 jobs, direct jobs in UK. I can say approximately 20% of global offshore production, which is today, is near to 100 million barrel a day. So at least 20 million barrel a day coming directly from the subsea engineering and underwater technology. There is a strategy in the United Kingdom just revealed in the last 12 months regarding the zero emission in 2050. It's called 2050 strategy, which means that by 2050, UK, United Kingdom will not rely on any oil industry and need the emissions to be net zero. It's a major challenge to reach that, but we'll talk in later slides about how this will be reached. Update and spotlight on global economy. Second quarter results. As you know, just 3 weeks ago, the second quarter results of the major countries in the world and major oil major producers just revealed. And I will give you some hints about and spotlight about the very important numbers so we can understand the economical problems the whole world facing today. We have shrinkage in the GDP. The GDP is the gross domestic products, which is measuring the all the values of all products and services in each country. In US, the shrinkage is 33%, exactly 32.9%. In UK, United Kingdom, the shrinkage is 20.1. It's really showing that the economy of the most important countries in the world severely impacted by COVID-19. And I can say that it's not only COVID-19, but before that, we were in towards a global economy crisis, but the COVID-19 accelerated the impact of the global economic crisis, just accelerator. But we have noticed before end of 2019, globally, in most of numbers, of economical numbers, there is a slowdown in the global economy noticed in the last two quarters last year, and even the first quarter this year, you know, COVID-19 started the impact everywhere during March. But the first quarter, even I will show after the first quarter, shows that the global economy is suffering a lot. So we have shrinkage in the GDP, US 33, UK 20%. Stock market and shares plunge. As all of you noticed in the global market, we can see the shares drop by around 50% in March, in 20th of March. Actually, it was declining of the price of shares in the most important companies. I can say in Exxon, in PV, in British Petroleum, in Far East, major companies also. It was a major fall in the values of most of energy companies, not only energy, most of the business, but in energy companies, which is our subject is related to, fall by 50% in the third week of March. And later on, some corrections happened, but still we are less than, I can say, just the market corrected by 10% after 20th of March for most of company shares. So, and also have major drop in global trade between countries. The global trade between countries, most of the trade is by shipping. 80% by trade is by shipping and land transportation. Both of them need fuel. So is based in oil industry products, refineries. So the major drop happened and the lockdown, after the lockdown in March, really affected the total consumption of fuels and even the requirements of the major refineries in the world. Second point, we have a major drop in building and construction activities worldwide. The construction and the building activities need fuel to build and to construct the factories and the roads and the major projects. All of those investments freezed in the last 3 months. The travel industry under severe pain, which is really one of the points showing the strength of the global economy and also the economy of each country. So the travel ban happened, which being as impact of COVID-19 mainly affected on the travel industry, the fuel required for the air flights. This also affected on the oil price as a total. More than 20 million jobs lost in US as per its latest published figures. In UK, we have at least 750,000 jobs lost. These direct jobs, but the actual indirect jobs, I think, is triple that number. Unemployment rate jumped from 4.4 to 14.7 in US. And in UK, we have 3 million job seekers. Moving from unprecedented recession, which is confirmed now, we are in a recession. In the beginning of the year, even before COVID-19, the most economical analysts talking about, are we going to recession or not? But in my expectation at that time, we are in a recession. We fall already in a recession. And the question is not, are we going to a recession or not? The question is, are we going to depression or not? A big difference between recession and depression. So according to the previous two quarters, if we will stay in shrinkage for another two quarters, I think in next January or February, it will be confirmed global depression. So these above factors and reasons led to a major drop of 20% of global energy consumption in the second quarter. And even after some better figures started to showing in the last week, still if you are very optimistic, we are talking about 15%. But I can confirm that in April, it was between 25 and 30% drop in the global energy consumption. This really not affected only oil and gas, affected any energy industry. Any energy industry was hit by this major drop in the consumption. In the next figure, in the next slide, we'll talk about what happened from March to June. All of us know what happened. The COVID-19 outbreak and the global lockdown declared everywhere. Sudden stop of global economy wheel. Major drop in oil price on 20th of March. West Texas in the intermediate was at $22. It was the worst week since January 1991, followed by the worst day ever in history in 20th of April. I will come later to the point of 20th of April. A share market plunge on 20th of March, as we said previously, Wall Street worst week since 2008, since the financial crisis. Dow Jones lowest point since December 16. The value, total value is 19,173 points. Worst week loss ever. The worst week loss ever in the history of Dow lost 4,000 points in a week. Declining of investment and bank funds to projects. Cash flow and supply chain complications because of closing borders between countries and travel ban and shipping and logistics problems, complicated problems to transfer materials from country to country, global economical crisis being confirmed. And it's not financial, it's economical crisis, a big difference between financial and economical. What happened in 2008 was financial problems. You can repair the financial system by some actions from major countries. But economical crisis, it need change in the structure of the economy to avoid not to think in global recession. Industry and workforce at risk. We have stopped in most of projects, and also declining of oil price affecting on oil producers and oil contractors, subcontractors, manufacturers, service providers, vendors, and we have seen a lot of job cuts and cancellation of organizational posts. But in some countries like UK, try to support the companies and all workers in the first 3 months and extended to another 3 months of support in order to avoid cancellation of the jobs. In this very famous figure showing the oil price from 1983 till 20th April 2020, we can see we have several ups and downs in the oil price in the last 35 or 37 years. But the major change, it was in 2008 when the oil price jumped to 147 per barrel and dramatic fall to 35 in very few weeks. These fluctuations affecting severely on the industry at that time. After that, we have some recovery during 2009 and 10, and major increase in the oil price above $100 in 2011, 12, 13. And in 14, we have another drop to below 70 and stayed struggling on in 60s and 50s dollars in 16, 17, 18. This instability in oil price affected most of future plans of increasing the productions in countries, explorations, and new drilling programs in IOCs and NOCs, and the funding and financing for projects, because it's not easy to make the analysis and make the final decision of investment on this fluctuation in the last 10 years, because when you are making this analysis, we need to see more stable market in order to go ahead in projects. But most of people think that the formula, it's only supply and demand. But we need to make a focus on that point. Who is controlling the supply and demand? It's not free supply and demand. There is a competition between the superpowers in the world, US, Russia, China, and the remaining countries of G8. You can add also in the second layer, the remaining countries of G20. All of those countries are utilizing the oil and gas as a tool, a power tool. I can say power tool, so they can control the range. I can say the range of the oil price, it should be between X1 and X2. So the oil producers under whatever oil producers are countries like NOCs or companies like IOCs are under many pressures to react to the superpowers, how they increase the production or decrease the production, and to whom to sell the oil, and the future plans. All of those fundamental decisions not owned by the IOCs and NOCs 100%. Many, many pressures comes on them, and they are taking into consideration the pressures to reduce. We have seen that many times. If you follow, for example, the Saudi Arabia production from early 17s, when the production increased from 3 million to 7 or 8 million and decreased again to 3 million and increased again to 10 million and decreased again to 6 million and decreased again to 12 million. So all of this, in my opinion, is under some pressures, not only to increase the income of IOCs, NOCs, but also under some negotiation and the requirements from superpower. All of us know that the oil price is affecting the U.S. election. Any president need more jobs. So the good oil price is helping him, but very good oil price not helping the U.S. strategy, because U.S. will not be very happy if the oil price will be above 100 for a long time. This will give very strong economy for Russia, for example. So it's we have many points in the formula, and I can say geopolitics playing a significant role in that. The geopolitics, especially in region like Middle East, and East Mediterranean, West Africa, and in Venezuela, Mexico and Brazil. I think there is current geopolitics and the future geopolitics. I think this geopolitics affecting severely the oil price formulas. Global economy, China effect also one of the points affecting the oil price when the economy of China is going up with very good figures in the last 15 years. This requested the global industry to increase the production. Do you know that the total worldwide production in 1965, it was only 32 million barrels a day, okay? And in 1990, the total production is almost 65 million, it's double. In 25 years, but the 65 million barrel a day increased by 10 million in during 19th, and from 2000 until today, jumped to 100 million barrel a day. I think the total jump, the big jump from 2000 till today, it was based on the very good progress of China and India as a major consumer of oil. So the very good results of the of China and India and other developed countries also in Far East and in Africa helped a lot in putting a pressure on the market to increase the production and putting major exploration and production plans to be in first track and attracting the funds and finance with hundreds of billions of dollars a year to be in the table in order to meet the increase in the global consumption. So we are talking about U.S.-China tension, U.S.-Russia tension and the relationship, the pressures on OPEC organization, OPEC plus one, OPEC plus Russia agreement, which started after in 2016 to correct the plunge of oil price at that time, which is really make a very good progress in that. And also today we are in the transformation of the NOCs and IOCs, the joint ventures. All of that playing factors in defining the oil price, or not, we can say not defining, make the balance of the oil price. What happened in 20th of April, it was touching a point which is global storage capabilities. It reaches the maximum. More than 600 million barrel stored everywhere. In tankers, in storage tanks, mega storage tanks everywhere, it reached to the maximum. So it was just what happened is a theoretical figure, just theoretical price after 2 months, because we are selling the oil, giving the future figures on trade, but it's just 1 point, the global storage capabilities affected the oil price cipher. I need to jump on floating production asset installation outlook. Today we have some figures. This figure from Axiom floating production market, this confirmed figures just published few weeks ago, giving us what happened and the response of the market after COVID-19. And we can see in yellow the post COVID-19 forecast for this figure is related to subsea engineering. We are talking about FPSO, FLNG. FLNG is a floating LNG facilities. FPSO is a floating production storage of floating facilities. The FPS, but here we are excluding other types. This measure, mainly it's new productions from subsea fields where we are utilizing the subsea engineering in ultra deep water. We are in UK almost, we are putting like 15, in average 15 installations a year, and we can see the impact in 2020. But we can see before the COVID-19, the forecast was declining between the good figures in 18, is down to 19, but in 20, the figure is not like the forecast because of the COVID-19, and the forecast will see some better progressing, but will not go to the figure of 2018 before 4 or 5 years. This showing the global economy impact. So there is a roadmap of recovery plans to overcome the current challenges. Before that, because our main subject is subsea engineering of the oil and gas and offshore industry, the subsea engineering is still a power tool. It's a power tool because a lot of people are afraid that the subsea engineering or subsea industry will be collapsed. No, it's a power tool. I have a friend in very strategic positions in major IOCs and NOCs, and one of decision makers of one of the major IOCs told me frankly in a meeting, really it is the first company in the projects in investment in most of countries in subsea engineering. He told me, Before 2015, we can develop the ultra deep water on a cost plan of 70 US dollar per barrel. This our estimation, and we are working on that in the projects and in the approvals of FIDs. But you know, we cannot win the market. It's a power of a country, the subsea engineering to develop ultra deep water in some countries is a power of a country, of a superpower country. So they did a major and very comprehensive reviews of the engineering, of the manufacturing, of the services, how we can decrease that, because oil price will not stay at $70 after 2016. So he told me after that, after cycles of reviews, we are happy to stay in the market and going to develop ultra deep water fields with a cost of 40 US dollars per barrel. It was a massive work to reach that point. You can see the competition between the ultra deep water and traditional oil. All of us know that the traditional oil in some countries just costing an OPEX. I talk about OPEX plus CAPEX. OPEX plus CAPEX in most of countries, traditional one, to oil barrel, I talk about $10 to $15 in most of OPEX plus CAPEX. But to reach less than $40, in ultra deep water, we talk about 2,000 meter water depth. By the way, yesterday just published in Petrobras, they awarded $1 billion project to develop one of Santos basin in ultra deep water in Brazil. This basin, the water depth is 2,100 meter water depth. So you can see. The industry is still very needed, and just we are in a time just to adjust the progress of the industry. The industry capability in 2008 till 2010, it was as in a very good shape, but in the last 10 years, it's doubled for a reason. But what we can say, the industry will shrink, but not shrink too much. We'll shrink till the fleet and the capabilities of 2010. So no worries about that point. And I will go later how we can compensate that shrink in the renewable, so the subsea engineering, in my opinion, will not be impacted severely. Just we are in the couple of years to adjust the revenue of the companies, talk about services, manufacturing, EPC contractors, mainly fleet owners, and IOCs, NOCs. But still, we have a very good plans for the future, especially with when we are integrating the offshore as not only the oil, but adding the focusing on gas fields plus the wind farms. So the roadmap for recovery of the plans to overcome the challenges, we have taken a very long list of lessons learned from 2009 and 15. We learned for diversification, going to renewable. It was a hard decision at that time, but I think the plans will come again on the table in order to increase the investment on renewable, maybe the floating wind farm. I think it's a future. The resilient, efficient operations and budget control. I need to talk in details here about the cost control of IOCs and NOCs, and what's the steps and the roadmap in order to control the budgets. First, we need a slowdown in FIDs, the final investment decisions of approved projects, which are not critical or affecting the performance of operations for a duration at least a year. We are in economical crisis, and will take in some expectations between 18 and 36 months. So we need to slow down on the approved projects, FIDs. We need to review the 5 years business plan and consider oil price is between 35 and 40. Dollars per barrel on average, and restrict oil plans based on that. If the oil price, even according to the superpower competitions, going up for a while, some expectation maybe will touch 50, it will go down again. If it will stay for 3-4 months, it will go down again. So don't build your 5 years plans on very optimistic plans. A comprehensive review of each business case, supporting approved projects in executions in all phases, from concept, FEED, pre-FEED, FEED, detailed engineering before EPC award, and even after the EPC award. We need to review carefully and in comprehensive way these business cases and see what is the situation currently, and if we really need to move forward in investment in that project. Because as you are aware, the life of field will be extended by all means. So everywhere, and not only in developed countries, but the facilities installed offshore in early 70s and early 80s will remain till 2040. No major investment to change pipelines unless there is a need. But we have a lot of technical points we can cross over. We can rely on other facilities, suppose more ideas to continue utilization of these old fields. And also we have this commissioning. This another story of the field confirmed declining of the oil production. So the next point is postponement of first track plant project for another year, or find area of cost saving to make the project cost effective in worst-case scenarios of global crisis. Reconsideration of EPC contracts recently awarded to contractors by renegotiation renegotiating with contractors as per terms and conditions, find out solutions to reach win-win situation to all parties instead of project cancellation or delays in executions or dividing on phases. Combination of the services such as logistics, this area is really rich of saving. We can save a lot in logistic area. So combination of services such as logistics, saving offshore field operations. Sharing the resources between units, projects, and operations, establishing agreements to maximize the benefits to all parties without affecting the smooth operations performance. Merging units, the management of units, fields, projects, and regions. So we can working also on that. This will reduce the OPEX with very good figures, but without affecting the HSE asset integrity and quality. And without decreasing the workforce severely. Detailed review of company strategic objectives to match the global challenges and to reflect the flexibility of the organizations to respond smoothly to these fast changes in the energy market and to be on the track of energy transition requirement. These points, if will be applied, I think will control the budget of companies, which is already reshuffled during the last few months in the first cycle. I know we have some cycles before between 2015 till 2019, but this cycle it was needed, and I think that it will be followed by another couple of cycles in the next couple of years. Providing support to subsea workforce is very important. Restructuring and reorganizations of IOCs and NOCs is already happening, and I think more cycles of reorganizations is coming later. Government support to organizations, we can see that in the United Kingdom, very good support to companies and to workers as well during COVID-19 problem. Back to subsea industry, core business and regions. So as I explained, the subsea engineering and subsea industry is a power tool of countries, power tool of business. It's a power tool of relationship between countries. So just back to core business, because we have some expansions in the last 10 years outside the core business in some areas, which is good if the global economy is responding and give good, very good figures, but we'll go back to 2010 market capabilities in the subsea industry. Merging and acquisitions, all of us can see many merging and acquisitions between countries, even between, there's some talks about merging acquisition between some giants of EBC contractors, of service providers, of manufacturing, of very famous technique FMC happened, very famous Baker Hughes GE happened, but there is more and more of merging and acquisitions in business, subsea business, I think is coming. I think it will not only be subsea business, maybe it will be extended to see one of major IOCs will merge with another one, and major NOCs will be joint ventures with other companies. I will keep the Q&A till the end, and after I this presentation is update on one presentation I made in the beginning of July. Really, I was very happy to see a lot of roadmap already implemented in early August, 3 weeks ago, when we have seen British Petroleum published the new strategy and this new strategic objectives for the next 10 years till 2030. And I was very happy that my expectations and my analysis has been confirmed as a very good roadmap to the industry. So I will read what happened in, and what published in early August after 1 month of my presentation. I can say I cannot say identical, but I can say most of the points is here are here. The strategy includes the following specific actions of British Petroleum. It will increase the annual low carbon investment tenfold to approximately $5 billion. They are focusing. They will focus on the oil and gas business on value, reducing the production by 40% with no exploration in new countries. This impact of the superpower. Superpower requested from OPEC, from IOCs, NOCs to reduce the production to absorb the too much millions of barrel in the market. We have my friend Fatih Birol in Paris, as we met before many times, and is the head of of International Energy Agency. All the figures and all numbers with him, and he confirmed that 10 million barrels need to be removed from the market of the daily production, so we cannot stay at 100 million barrel production because the total consumption now is less than 90 million barrel a day. So all producers need to have a one-step back. Today we can see British Petroleum confirming that the plans to reduce 40% of the total production by 2030, which is equal to 1 million barrels. And we have seen that Russia have stepped back. We have Aramco step back. We have been most of OPEC producers and non-OPEC producers as well. All of them confirming the step back. Make partnerships with 10 to 15 cities and three core industries in decarbonization efforts. They will also providing more than 70,000 electric vehicle charging points, up from 7,500 today, lowering the emission from operations by 30 to 35% by 2030. This on the route to zero emission by 2050, as per the strategy. Lowering the emission associated with carbon in the upstream oil and gas production by 35 to 40%, reducing the carbon in, intensity of the products PV cell by 15% by 2030. Even they are quitting from the chemicals, as we said, we back to core business. Activities focus areas will include the following: building scale in renewable. Actually, in UK, we can. I have some figures. We need 30 gigawatt additional 30 gigawatt from renewable by 2030, and by 2050, we need additional 30 gigawatt to reach 90 gigawatt in the next 30 years. So the 1 gigawatt need approximately £1 billion pound investment. So this very good area of investment of 30 billion pound in renewable, it's needed, and I think it's the plans on the table now. Before it was focusing on east of Scotland, and now the plans to focus on west of Scotland in the ocean, and the water depth will go deeper and deeper for floating wind farm. I think the first going will be till 57 meter water depth, and the wind speed is I think 9.7 or near to 10 meter per second. So that technologies we will have will transfer all the whole knowledge in subsea engineering in the oil and the gas industry to the renewable, which was very slow in the last 10 years, I think it will be accelerated in the coming 10 years by values of investment and transfer the knowledge and experience of executions of the projects of the subsea engineering and taking the know-how and transform that how to help in reducing the estimated cost of wind or renewable projects from offshore. By the way, it's a plan. It's one of the plans to find integrated offshore energy. It's now this new definition. It's called integrated offshore energy to give around 30% requirement from the reducing of the emissions in UK. So that means it will be a strong focusing on that. By the way, the gas, when we are saying oil and gas, the gas is clean energy, considered clean energy today in the policies with policymakers everywhere. So I think a huge investment will go to gas fields as well. As we can see in the geopolitics, the East Mediterranean, it's mainly subsea engineering required for gas field development, and the expectation is very high in that area. Also, that we have very good expectations in UKCS continental shelf and the Norwegian as well, and in other countries, developed countries. So the subsea engineering will be utilized more and more in gas, more than oil in the future. But the policymakers are considering the gas is very important. That's why they are considering it's a clean energy in definition, in order to avoid talking about the emissions about gas. Being customer-centric, helping accelerate the global revolutions in mobility, we are talking here about the fuel sales in growth markets, maintaining the hydrocarbon resilience by maintaining an absolute force focus on safety and operational reliability and the high grading portfolio, resulting in significantly lower and more competitive production. As we can see, the oil and gas industry will not be impacted severely as people talking in the last few months, or hydrocarbon industry will remain on the top of energy agenda, at least for between 30 years plus in 50 years, and even after that, the importance will go to, we'll say gas and oil, will not say oil and gas. So it's still, we are integrated between both of them, and we have a very good future in our industry. But during the next couple or 3 years, we have a restructuring of the industry, of the companies, on the economical plans. So in these 3 years, the trend will be down before going up again. My expectations before 2023, but at that time, after all preparations, will be a huge investment in renewable, in gas projects, and also will remain will at the time after freezing a lot of oil projects, will need this, some projects to maintain the production after the global crisis. So the annual consumption will go back. The expectation for annual consumption will be between 90 and 105. This is between 2025 until 2040. So to maintain that figure from oil and the oil fields, I think a lot of projects will be on fast track from beginning of 23. So a lot of points give positivity in our situation, and the subsea engineering remain a power tool for superpowers, and still very competitive and very needed in the future for the gas first for the renewable, second and thirdly for the oil. In that figure, last figure, the British Petroleum 2030 goal of resilient and focused hydrocarbons, we can see the aims of British Petroleum. I will go back. The presentation slides will be available for people. And also, I am planning to give more webinars, our request to explain more subjects in our industry linked with the policies and the future plans, current situations, the analysis and projects, operations, size with the current situation of the superpower tensions. I will go back to the questions, this end of the slide. And I am very happy to receive questions from you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Engineer Ibrahim. We have a couple of questions for you. So the first question asking from half, does not zero mean that by 2050 there won't be any more oil and gas production?
I answer. I think the policymaker considering gas is not giving emissions, so the gas is outside the story. So the gas is we need the gas. So we talk about the oil, emissions from the oil. By the way, I was a judge in one of the best prestigious awards and projects in the hydrocarbon industry, and most of projects who are judging is gas. Even in UK, I have seen in 3 years ago, the winner of the projects, it was West of Shetland project, it's gas, mainly gas project. It's the investment at that time, it was £7 billion. And more gas projects under execution now in UK. So the gas is embedded in the policy, in the strategy. And we need gas for at least 100 years. You can see the geopolitics in East Mediterranean. We need gas.
Okay. Omar asked, what's the difference between recession and depression?
Recession is a shrinkage in the GDP for 2 quarters. If this extended to another two or to cover 5 quarters, it remains. So that means you fall in depression.
Okay, thank you, Engineer Ibrahim. Today, webinar will be available on Biobitter YouTube channel as usual. And if you haven't subscribed to the channel yet, please do and share this webinar on your Facebook page and invite others to join Arab Oil and Gas Academy Facebook page. Thank you, Engineer Ibrahim. And that's all for today. Wish everyone a lovely evening. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much, and thank you everyone for your time to watch our presentation, and we hope to be in touch in more webinars. Thank you.